You ever gotten drunk with Chad Kroeger? I should just stop.
Save that for Hold on. That's going to be the first question.
Wow. Oh, my goodness. Well, we are rolling, aren't we? This is Cool Story, Bro. I'm Walt. I'm here with Krista.
Hi.
And this is where we kind of look and see what goes on, how the music business gets where it is. You're like, what goes into it? There are so many different facets. I mean, we all know artists, but there are also other factions to the music industry. And we have one of the guys who's responsible for one of those, who is looking the other.
I am a faction person.
He is a faction of the faction. The music industry. James Howard from iHeartRadio, who is also my boss, but
not in this room, not now. Unleash the beast, bro.
That's right, man.
Get
it's
in
all
my face.
Me.
Fantastic. Because our first question is: have you ever gotten drunk with Chad Kroeger from Nickelback?
Yes, I have, and that guy's a good time.
Cool story, bro.
Tell Great it. Story. Yeah, we got drunk, and that was it. Nothing happened.
That was the end of the story. That is indeed a cool story.
See, everybody's got a Nickelback story, though. I think if you're,
I hope so.
Well, I mean, like they opened for Stabbing Westward in Vancouver.
Yep.
In 1998, maybe,
okay.
They were the local support band mm-hmm. on a Stabbing Westward show. Didn't see them. Stepped over the crowd in between bands to get to the stage. But it was years later that...
You didn't even acknowledge him, did
one
you?
One of the guys...
Shame on you.
One of the guys in the band came up to me at a festival in Minneapolis, and he goes, hey, you're in Stabbing Westward. Hey, man, how's it going? We opened for you guys once. I'm like, oh, that's cool. Oh, yeah, in Vancouver. Great. Yeah. What are you guys up to now? Oh, we just finished recording this new record. It comes out next month. And the first single, How You Remind Me.
Wow. And the rest was absolute history.
Now they won't take my calls. But, you know, what are you going to do?
I feel like Chad would actually take your call. You know, I mean, and it's funny. This is a circumstance where you didn't get a chance to be a mentor, right? Like, you didn't get a chance to, like, walk them through what you had already gone through. Because you,
right.
I mean, I think everyone thinks everyone's backstage, you know, just doing the craziest, you know, things possible together. And it's like this party all the time. And a lot of times it's very professional, right? Like you were a
Seriously.
Professional band there for a job.
Well, and I think that there's two different things, right? There are bands that have the party element about them and everybody knows that they're a party and they think of them, they put them on a pedestal because of that. But then they're the ones that are all business. Yeah. And they kind of get taken down a notch, but they always end up being more successful in the end.
Uh-huh. So. They show up on time. They don't die twice.
That's right.
Always a good rule.
What are you talking about there?
You don't die. It's never good to die multiple times
no.
in your career.
No, definitely not.
Especially literally.
So, James, your current title is the Regional Senior Vice President of Programming.
You had to look that up.
I did. looked at an email. I'm like, what's the official title?
What is this guy
What
do?
Is this title? But yep. you didn't start there.
No.
Tell me how you got into the business.
You know, intern, you know, working for free. You know, free labor was a thing back in the day, right? And now, like, we have to pay people to work. It's obnoxious. but it was just, I just wanted to get in the door. You know, I was an insurance salesman and... I hated that, but I listened to the radio all the time when I was going from call to call. And I was like, man, like, and I heard an advertisement on the radio saying you too could be in radio. So I went to broadcasting school and learned not much. But
so
I learned
you,
how
you
to
were
get
really
in the
selling
door.
Insurance before that.
Yeah.
How old were you at this point?
21.
So you're just a baby.
I was a baby. Yeah. 21. And ironically, I'll never forget it. I was having lunch with my boss at the time and he said in 25 years, you could be me. And I was like, I have to do something different. this is not good.
Your insurance boss said that?
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah.
I was like, oh, God, 25 years to be you? this is not a brightness
That's a death
of future.
Sentence.
No, it's a bad idea. And then I heard that radio advertisement.
Nothing
and
against insurance sales.
No,
by
we
by
love
the way.
Insurance. You know, when you don't have insurance, it's uncomfortable.
I don't have insurance. And, you know, you get on just fine until you
don't. Until you don't, yeah.
Buy insurance. This show is sponsored by Witherite Law Group.
Please, somebody insure Krista. Because we need her. She's very valuable.
She's very
here.
Valuable.
So, like, you saying that has me concerned now.
Guys,
we need to talk about that.
I'm pretty sure insure me. I just don't think I signed up for it.
What?
There's a lot of things I don't do.
Oh, my God, Krista.
Do I have a 401k?
Okay, that's a different
okay, that's
podcast.
A different podcast. Yeah,
next
sure.
week.
Financial advice with Krista.
Bad decisions.
Let me give you good financial advice.
We offer insurance as part of the... Okay, we'll go... Nevertheless.
Sidebar.
Back to that. I ended up getting an internship at a rock station in Orlando, Florida. And I worked for a guy named Buckethead. Brightness of Future. And he taught me a lot of...
Doesn't play guitar, does he?
No, it wasn't the Buckethead who ended up being a guitarist for Guns N' Roses for a moment there. He was just a radio, you know, douche, you know, night guy, just like, I mean, we did some pretty obnoxious things back then because it was a different time. Like, and comedy is not evergreen. Remember, like that things you did 20 plus years ago are different.
Definitely
are not accepted
some
now.
Some of them are not funny now.
Let's not go for the tape. Don't go for the tape. But we did some stuff, and I learned a lot from him, and I got an opportunity, and then you know got a chance to work overnights. You know, like you know midnight till 5 a.m.
That was your first full time thing. Doing overnights. Well, mine too.
Yeah, really? Okay, yeah. There you go. Yeah. And you know, there's something very interesting and important about connecting with people just like you who are having a job that most people don't have. And I got so much value out of talking to people every single late night because it was the people of the macabre. It was these people.
Isn't it weird? People awesome. Did. They came out of the woodwork to, like, they thought you were their best friends. And, like, look, I really like the people who call up and listen to us on the radio. But, like, it's just weird. They you take on a different level of a friendship with those guys, especially when you get to the late at night crew. It's cool.
You feel lonely when you're a security guard and it's 2 a.m. And then you realize there's somebody else right there with you doing the same thing.
Right.
And that caught me. And I'm like, I just want to do this for the rest of my life. I just want to, like, you know, tell stories and goof off, you know, dick jokes, all the things that we're shooting for. And then at some point in my career, there was a juncture of, do you want to continue to do the on-air thing or do you want to, you know, go into management? Which at the time I wanted money.
Yeah.
And so I went into management.
Do you miss being like the an on-air everyday type of a thing? Or
I do. Mainly because of I love the connection I had with the audience. I loved talking to other people every day and getting that energy transfer back. You know this because you do this, you know, every single day. There's something special about, even though you're in a room by yourself.
It's the weirdest thing, my friend.
But you have an energy that is building throughout the day with people that aren't in the same room as you. And it happens and it's really special. And I do love that. But I get a chance to live it through you and others. And I've been able to learn a lot more about, like, not just humanity, but like music, all genres, things like that, that I wouldn't have been able to do if I just told dick jokes.
Yeah.
I was a one trick pony.
It is true though. I mean, it's so bizarre. You're in a room by yourself. You're talking. I mean, in most worlds, you're a crazy person, but you're actually talking to hundreds of people.
Or, hear this.
I mean, what? It's just an amazing connection. I mean, like, today the weather is beautiful. So, like, you know, we're talking about rolling down the window and going down the road. And that connection, you can feel it when they call back, they text in. It's great.
It's almost like they have you stalk out the window like a dog with you.
With
you
know, tongue,
just with your tongue going, the hair wagon. Going, like, all that. It's just, it happens.
So, I take it you started liking rock. Was your format?
Absolutely. Rock, like, has been my passion from moment one. It just.
But have you been in a band?
No. Terrible musician.
Have you tried?
Yes. My fingers are not as nimble as yours, right? You can do a lot of incredible musical things with your fingers. I'm not hitting on him. It's just what he can do. I struggle with that. I played the piano a little bit when I was growing up, but I didn't have the discipline. I didn't have the, you know, the musicality for it. But I've always loved it. And I loved, like, listening for the interesting little things you hear in songs that other people don't notice. I hear them. So I have some musicality, but I just didn't have the, I like to move on to lots of projects all the time. I just have the discipline.
Was there any one thing that other than the commercial that's like, I got to play music for somebody on the radio? Yeah. Or was there a DJ? Was there a band that inspired you to be more down the music path?
That's a good question. I've always just loved music. I always feel like the room is always better when music is on. Any room, anywhere, even if it's not a room, it's outside. If you walk down the street and then all of a sudden you hear somebody busking and you hear like a street musician, you're immediately in a better space. Like, your head is, your heart is different. It's just in a better place. So, there's so many great rock bands and all bands. But actually, I grew up loving hip hop. I was a hip hop guy first.
Did you have the cap on the sideways?
No.
The big giant t-shirts?
No. And I never did the baggy pants thing, whatever. I was like the, you know, I was the honky who just wanted to understand a different culture. I mean, just candidly, I grew up in Miami, Florida, and hip hop was a big deal back then. And it was, this is NWA. This is like,
okay,
you know, and then even earlier than that, I just always loved rebellious music. I love music that, that told a story about fighting against something. Okay. I don't know why. Maybe it was because I was angsty. It was just like most teenagers were all angsty. Yeah. I didn't have anything really to complain about. I just wanted to have something to complain about.
Isn't that the biggest struggle? Not having a struggle.
Yeah, no. Woe is me.
It's hard. It's You're hard
right.
out here.
You're right. When you don't... Well, I have no meaning. I got to create meaning.
I have a pool. I have a beautiful house. My parents are successful. It feels rough.
It's awful.
Yeah.
Parents are still happily married. Jeez.
Oh, man.
Yeah, coming up on 52 years. Yeah.
What a drag right there.
You know,
not having to split Christmas.
Yeah. I deserve all of that. But I loved hip hop, and then eventually found rock. Grunge changed everything for me.
Yeah.
I was just like, oh, okay, this is a sound I understand.
Which bands?
I mean, initially it was Alice in Chains, and then you know, Nirvana came around, STP came around, Pearl Jam came around, you know, all of them, Candlebox, et cetera. And it was, that whole sound was just, I loved the guitar that was added to the angst. I just liked, and I loved the desperation in the vocals. Like, the desperation of music is one of my favorite things.
I was working in Top 40 radio at the time, and this is in the year of 91, and suddenly, in the fall, something snapped. Something mm-hmm. happened. I mean, it's when you look at what happened between August and October of that year, you had the Black Album, Nevermind, Pearl Jam 10, Blood Sugar Sex Magik, Siamese Dream from the Pumpkins. I mean, it's incredible.
Yep.
How everything changed within 3 months.
Yeah.
It still blows my mind. And the 90s were screwed from that point on, as far as, like, if you were Firehouse or Steelheart.
Oh, yeah.
You know, like, suddenly you were cruising in Top 40 radio, and suddenly you had nothing. Nobody cared. It was.
Yeah, it's like working at BlackBerry. Like, uh-oh. Like, right, what just happened to me?
And I what?
Yeah.
Incredible.
Yeah, I'll never forget it. And we were wearing flannel in Miami, Florida. Like, that doesn't make any sense.
Not at all.
But
no.
The fashion was cool, and we wanted to be, like, talk about peak of the power. I was in Seattle, right? Like, 91 was just everything in Seattle. You
know,
Sleepless in Seattle. It's a fantastic rom-com. Seattle Supersonics, you know, they were killing it.
Yeah.
You know, Sean Kemp, Gary Payton, I'm losing you.
We're good.
Actually, did a Special Olympics thing with Gary Payton.
Oh, good guy.
A couple of years ago. Yeah, he kind of made fun of me because I was trying to help the kids and whatnot. And he was like, I want the ball, man. He's like, no, I'm okay, dude. Here you go. You're the superstar.
Oh, he was fighting the Special Olympic kids.
Great guy, though.
Cool. Nice job, Gary.
Great guy.
Yeah, that was a great time for Seattle. That's for sure. And we dug it all the way across the country in Miami. It came to us and we're like, oh, this is cool.
So, radio. How effective is radio at helping a music artist?
It's extremely effective because I know sometimes, you know, there's so many options for people to consume music and to consume entertainment. We're on a podcast right now, so that means that you're consuming things in modern ways. But we have this massive reach that everyone continues to use radio to connect with where they live and people that are like them and the music that are similar, right? And when we play something on the radio, it's not just in that singular moment, which most people consume radio by themselves, right? You're in a car by yourself or you're going for a run by yourself. But you have 800,000 or a million, or like a radio station like WCHI has a massive reach. When you hear something there, there's a lot of other people around you that are doing the same thing. And just like anything, finding consensus is very difficult, but radio is a consensus location where a lot of people can hear something and break an artist. And, you know, you and I have been lucky enough in our career to be able to break a ton of artists over the years just by playing something on the radio. And some of the biggest bands of all time started on radio. And after that,
does that still happen today?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, look, I mean, I manage WCHI, but we also have current-based formats here. So we have Kiss FM just down the hall, which is all about brand new music, WGCI. They're breaking hip-hop artists that are Grammy Award-winning, like, from Chicago. Like,
right.
This is a great hip-hop and R&B market for America, and a lot of the best talent come from here. And so we're breaking artists all the time. That's not the design of Rock 95.5. The Rock 95.5 is the mental treehouse that I think everyone deserves.
Yeah.
Like, you go back into a space and know that that's the music that you care about. Even though you do an incredible job, obviously, every Sunday night with playing new music and the new noise. And when we get some new music, we will play it.
And
but we just don't.
And that, I truly like to be like up front and try to have still a hand in breaking those new rock bands when I do that. A'Ron Jones from Seattle, a great guitar player, singer. He's got swagger. He's kind of like a Lenny Kravitz kind of guy. Sleep Token is breaking out of the UK. They're kind of like a new Ghost, but with some modern electronic vibe. I mean, and I like to play that stuff, going like, just here, check this out,
Try something new.
Right. And that's always been what it has been for me. When I was a kid, I knew I was going to, I would listen to WLS AM because I was in Macomb, way off in the countryside. Mm-hmm. And I knew it was like music drives me. It's either I'm either going to play music on the radio for people or I'm going to play music in a band for people. And I ended up being able to do both.
Someone's an overachiever.
but you just know. And I've always had that passion about turning people on to new things. And here, check this out. Check this out.
So. Yeah. There's something about like the bond that comes from liking something that's the same.
Yeah.
And we all covet that in our life. Like we surround ourselves with people who are similar to us because we want to have those connections. That's what we get a chance to do every day. We bond over the fact that we care about these songs and these bands and what they meant. And in this format, better than ever. Like rock is more than a disposable song. It's an album. It's a story. It's a moment. And not all types of music are like that.
Right. How does a song get on the radio?
You know what? It's just like anything. It's like the access point is hard. You think about how many talented people are out there that deserve to be on the radio, right. And we've been able to see them, again, busking on the street. You hear something, you go, wow, listen, that's a generational voice. How is that person not on the radio? How is that person, not in a streaming device? It's about, being lucky, A, B, having great representation in terms of somebody who has access to a radio station or access to a record label. And then it's just doing the work and going out there and playing in front of people. And usually it builds that way. So I throw that same thing back at you. You had to break with Stabbing Westward. How did you do it?
It's like, well, we actually didn't do the club thing as heavy as a lot of bands do back in the day. We actually took our time to work on the demos and we said, we're going to do, concentrate on this because
you were the Steely Dan of the 90s.
We're the industrial. We have all of the other things going on. So we're going to go and concentrate on this. Then we shopped it and we got a record deal with Roadrunner Records. But the contract, they wanted 98% of everything. And so we're like, well, we know a lawyer. Let's have him look at this. It's like, you don't want to sign this.
This is bad.
We're like, yeah, we do. It's a record contract. What are you talking about? Of course we want to sign this. He's like, don't. Here, let me take this and see if I can shop it to some other labels and see what we get.
And once you had the early interest, that piqued everybody else.
It piqued everybody else. We had a rehearsal space in what was Caprini Green at the time.
Oh, delightful.
And in a building that was being turned into a recording studio because it was trying to gentrify. And we would bring record reps to this building in Caprini Green, and they would be freaked out. And we'd bring them upstairs, and sure enough, one offered us a development deal where we could get in a van with $20,000 and go do it. And then Columbia's just like, we want our own Nine Inch Nails, and here you go. Let's go.
Was there a bag of cocaine on the contract?
There wasn't. Got it. Noted. But they did fly us to New York and put us in a limo for the first time with booze in the back.
That's how you close a deal.
So we were very happy with that, and we took that deal.
Did the limo have, like a bottled water there, or do they have something a little more adult?
Oh, it was more adult. Gotcha. It was definitely they had the bottle with the crystal bottle with the thing on there.
Oh,
so everybody
nice.
Was drinking in the back. They're like, "This is here we go, guys. This is good.
We've made it." And then the hard work began.
Yeah, but that's the thing. Do you think bands no longer put in the work that is required that maybe they used to do 20 years ago?
I think accessibility to ears is easier now than before. Whereas before, people would go to the small rock club, and that's how you would find them. Now, with all these great social media, Krista, obviously being a social media maven here, she'll know better than anything. Like TikTok is breaking so many artists because it's an easy and accessible place to find entertainment and music at the same time. And that's what's, and obviously it's also resurging a bunch of music. I mean, Stabbing Westward will probably be a beneficiary at some point. Someone's going to do a dance.
Your lips to God's ears.
Right? What do I have to do is going to be like some weird sped up dance and you're going to get rich.
I've been waiting. Please. Somebody.
Metallica saw exactly that when it came to Stranger Things.
Yeah.
There's so many more access points, I think, for somebody who loves music to find music.
But also on the flip side of that, because there are so many of these avenues now, it's harder for people to actually hear that, and to land on the one where it's taking off because there's so many more options.
Fragmentation.
Yeah.
Consensus is the hardest thing as we do a lot of research to find out what do people think and care about. Like, we don't just sit around in a room. Like, you could legitimately, because you're so talented, decide what music to play and have a successful radio station because of it. But you're rare. Most of us have to ask questions to the audience to figure out what they want. And the hardest thing for us to all figure out is what's
the consensus?
What's at least 80%, yeah. You know, like we're in the ballpark. Like, and then you have the other little things. But our job is to keep people with us as often as possible. And so if we play music that's fragmented, you won't have a group of people who just absolutely love a radio station. So it's hard. You're right. And so when you have a fragmented experience, social media, you know, every digital option on the planet, including radio and music television, obviously, is gone by the wayside. But YouTube took that space and has done a great job in that space. Why am I promoting our competitors? but these are just the truths and realities of where and, people can
and that's,
find it.
And that's really it. What has changed in the music business in the past 20 years? How is it different? I mean,
so much.
I mean, we don't have an hour and a half.
I was going to say.
But,
I think what's the good thing about change is we get better. We get, we learn more. We have better access to information. We understand our audiences better. We understand music lovers a little bit better. But with the more information you have, the more difficult sometimes those decisions become, because now you can be paralyzed by data and paralyzed by, like, what if we make a mistake or what if the audience doesn't love it? And I think about that. That's what keeps me up at night. Is like, what if we do something and the audience doesn't love it? Because this is why we're here.
Right.
We're here to do it for them. You know, in the money. but ultimately, this isn't a business to get rich. Crystal would be a perfect example of that. She doesn't have insurance.
Yeah.
Which we'll follow up with later this afternoon.
I'm Latino. It'll be fine.
You can lean on your heritage for that stuff sometimes. It's a lovely heritage. We'll follow up. Anyway, but you're not getting rich in the radio side of things. This is a passion business. Like, it's just either love it or you don't. Otherwise, don't get into it. You're not going to. You know, that's not the purpose of it. So that I think there's so many differences that's a big question that I'm stalling on, obviously, because the last 20 years have been such a crazy ride. But
well, I think we just already talked about some of it, the fact that there's so much fragmentation and other avenues to experience music. And it's not just it used to be very singular. It used to be live shows and radio. Mm-hmm. Stop. Then maybe a video game, then maybe a TV show and a movie. And now, like, the internet is just the Wild West. There's so many avenues there that I think that makes it far more challenging for new artists to find that avenue. Because the chances of somebody catching fire on TikTok are slim, right?
I wouldn't say slim. I think slim only because of people. Like, you have to consistently post until it happens. The reality is, and I hear this, like, with celebrities, too. Like, Oprah didn't make it until her, like, 30s, or same with like Lewis Black, didn't make it till he was almost like 50. Like, if you put in the work long enough, it'll happen. So like, my most watched video is about 2 million. But that came after a year of posting videos that got 200.
Right.
So it's how long are you willing to work for it, and how many risks are you willing to take to make it happen, which I think is similar in the music industry.
2 million views on a post.
I know.
That's incredible.
You know, it's funny. It was about my job. I thought I was getting fired. And there was a lot of people.
See, but you just you tapped a nerve with that.
I really did. But it's the same with music, too. I think what songs resonate with people, it's the ones that tap that nerve. Because people, music really is the ultimate therapist, right?
I think so.
Yeah. So tapping in that nerve, whether it's, you know, radio, social media, podcasting, that's where people come to feel seen and feel heard.
So one of the aspects to radio and music are live shows and festivals that radio stations have put on over the past 20 years. Are they still worth doing?
Oh, absolutely. From a radio station standpoint, as a promoter, I don't know. But what's one of the misnomers, and you hear this sometimes, and the fact I'm even repeating it is I'm going to yell at myself. Some people say that rock is dead. And they have no idea what they're talking about. Because the biggest festivals in the country, in the world, are rock festivals, right? Yep. That a large gathering of people who are there for the same purpose, the same type of music, and it's all rock music. And that's because there's nothing better than being at a rock festival show. It's just
for example, Sick New World featuring Stabbing Westward.
Ka-ching, sold out in a matter of moments.
There you go.
And when is that, Walt?
That is May 13th in Las Vegas. Sorry, it's sold out, but we just put on a show up for sale for the night before at the Brooklyn Bowl in Las Vegas. So if you're in town on Friday the 12th,
there you go.
Stop on by.
Ooh, VIP experience.
I love those like little smaller shows attached to a big festival, yeah. Right? Here in Chicago, like Lollapalooza has all those kind of versions of it. You can see the Red Hot Chili Peppers on the main stage, but then you have this cool little moment where you can go to a smaller club and see the Red Hot Chili Peppers, yeah. You know, and to see a Stabbing Westward in a smaller space is like really cool. So do that.
Yeah, it's cool to be able to do do that kind of thing.
Walt bought a new house. He needs more. He's got to put on shutters.
So, I mean, you've had your fair share of shows in the past doing livestock in Tampa.
Oh, yeah.
Whoops. Chili cook-off in D.C. What's the one story from those shows that speaks to you, that stands out?
Oh, wow. I mean, there's some mistakes that came. One was we ran out of water at one of them. Don't do that.
at livestock?
Yeah. It was just, you know, it was a hot day, and then we had to, like, get water there fast. And then, of course, the
And you're right there in
Zephyr Hills, Florida.
Right, where
the home of water.
The home of water.
Oh, no.
Who runs out of water there? My first ever show I ever put on as a promoter of it was in Albany, Georgia. Like, it was my first programming gig, and it was at a Hooters. And the Hooters ran out of wings. Again.
That's a win, though.
Yeah, look, we packed the place. The good news is success. I'm good at getting large crowds to a location. Feeding them and giving them beverages, not so good.
Did you have to fire fest it?
I mean, we gave up. You know, no, but the music carried on. They didn't need the wings. Plus, it was uncomfortable. Everyone's fingers were kind of messed up. It was like, we didn't think that through. It was just the only place that would have us. The Hooters was like, come on over here. So we backed up like this, you know, truck bed, essentially, and just had rock bands on the back of it. And it was 1,200 people showed up to a Hooters to watch local bands. And I was like, okay, this is pretty cool. One of my favorite moments, because I think about it earlier in my career, was the same location, but there's this weird location called the Parks at Cheehaw in South Georgia. And we didn't have security per se. We had some things that we were making mistakes on, but I convinced Seven Dust to come down from Atlanta and play it. And Seven Dust was really big at the time, that new metal sort of movement. And I love LeJean and Morgan and those guys. They're just like the best. And we did stuff back in Orlando, whatever. And we had like 7,000 people show up to this park. And it's actually in one of their videos. And it was like, because they
videoed that event?
Yeah, they videoed it that night. Broken Down, I think is the song. And it was a really cold night in South Georgia. It was like 34 degrees. And you could see the smoke and like just off their body heat was just, and it was just this epic night. And it was like, you ask LeJean now, he's like, it's one of the best crowds he's ever seen. Now, granted, there's so many things that could have gone wrong, and I've learned a lot more since then, but that was a pretty fun moment. But you see massive, you know, 40,000 person shows, the DC 101 Chili Cook-Off in DC was, you know, under the shadow of the Capitol building. It was just like, I can't believe this is happening.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was pretty cool.
Stabbing did livestock twice, I think, although we only played it once, because the first time a tornado or some massive storm rolled through and shut it down. Our bus got buried in mud. We had to get, I mean, it's like ridiculous to get it out. That was a crazy night. Then the next time through, Sammy was playing, and I got to hang out with him because I adored him growing up. And we had, there's a photo of us hanging out, drinking tequila. And it's just like the smile on my face couldn't be more genuine.
Now, did he have the Cabo Wabo back then?
Oh, yeah. Okay. Oh, yeah. So he was promoting.
He's the OG.
He was working it. I get it now.
And George Clooney, you learned from Sammy Hagar.
100%. 100%. Slash's Snake Pit was there. And I mean, it was just like, but it becomes very communal. And it's an amazing feeling when you're there, especially with people that you grew up admiring and they're welcoming. So, I mean, I have fond memories of that.
Well, what was that moment? I mean, this sounds like one of the moments, but that moment you felt like, and I don't know, maybe it was in the limo in New York where you felt like, okay, I made it. Like this, I'm doing this for a living.
You know, there was one. There was
always a good preface.
I think when we were opening up for Depeche Mode for the first go around in the fall of '94, we had put out the debut record. And we somehow were able to get on this Depeche Mode tour. Martin Gore picked us as his band. Dave Gahan picked Primal Scream for his band. So we did this tour at the end of the Songs of Faith and Devotion tour, doing the sheds outdoors. And to see that show night in and night out for 2 months was amazing. And then a month after that, we're playing festivals in Europe during the big festival season. And we have to play one in the Netherlands called Lowlands, and then play Reading the next day. But it just so happens that Martin Gore is having his wedding and reception the night of the Lowlands Festival. So we hightail it from the festival in Amsterdam, make it to this country club in the middle of nowhere for Martin Gore's wedding reception, where rock stars are being bussed in from London.
Wow.
And then we roll straight through the night onto stage at Reading, and you're going like, what is this life that I'm living? What is this? I mean, that was probably the peak where I'm like, all right, this is, I'm living in crazy world, and it's awesome.
And to this day, people throw their panties at him in Holland. It's just like, it's a thing. They were there last year, and, you know, just, you know, he got hit in the face with all sorts of undergarments, the unmentionables.
If only it were to happen. I hope it doesn't happen in the States.
Yes, married guy. Agreed.
Three records that define you. Go.
Three records that define me? Albums or, like, songs? Just talk.
Yes. Just speak words.
Yeah, I think Core. STP Core is one of those. I don't know why, if it defines me, but it defined my attitude towards music. That particular album like really kind of connected with me. That NWA record, that first one. I don't know if I can say the name of anything from NWA.
That's not.
But Straight Outta Compton. I think that was the album that like changed my life. I'm like, oh, okay, like. You could fight your way through this middle class lifestyle I had, and know that I could make it through and continue to middle class all the way through. Straight Outta Compton would be one. Just spitting off the top here. I'm trying to think of another one that would be great. I mean, it's hard not to go straight into a lot of the grunge stuff that I loved. I'm going to say this only because I'm going to go see this album perform live tonight.
Okay.
And it also started, most of my passion started with me being interested in a girl. And it usually leads me down the right path. It usually never left me towards the girl. Like,
right.
I loved a football team because the girl liked the football team and she never spoke to me again. But then, you know, the team was good, so I liked them. In this case, I was at a record store back in the day when those existed. And there was this woman who worked there, girl probably. She's probably, I don't know, 17 or 18 at the time. And I was younger and I just wanted to talk to her. And she told me to buy an album that she thought was really cool. And I'm like, of course I'm going to buy this album. I've heard all about this. This is amazing. I'd love this. And so I did.
Shooting fish in a barrel.
Yeah. I mean, she probably sold a lot of albums like this to dudes like me. Let me just tell you, Alanis Morissette probably really appreciated her as a salesman because Jagged Little Pill was an album that, first of all, I always knew that women rocked because of Joan Jett and Pat Benatar and some of the stuff that I grew up in the 80s listening to. But I didn't know that somebody could own that angst as well as she did. From start to finish, that album is fantastic. I love Jagged Little Pill.
Yeah, and it's odd. I didn't understand how much vitriol was in a song like you, like I Don't Know, until like the past year. It's like it just struck me like, oh my God.
Oh yeah, and there's tons of songs that kind of match that same tenor.
Yeah, so fantastic.
Yeah. What about you?
This is my podcast.
Oh, host could also be asked questions.
Okay.
If you don't want to go there, you want to think of Krista, we can go to Krista. I mean, I'm game for that.
Three Cheers, My Chemical Romance, Under the Cork Tree, Fall Out Boy, and then probably 808s and Heartbreak, Kanye West, 100%.
Well, okay. You had that in the holster.
Yes. Me and Walt just talked about this on our last episode. I still listen to all that music. I don't listen to a lot of new music. Like, I picked everything I am at 14 years old and just ran with it my entire life. And I was like, here we go. Don't have to do any more self-reflection than that.
But when we get her a chance to meet My Chemical Romance, I will make up for the fact that she doesn't have insurance.
Or Kanye. Like, I'm really, guys.
I'm not going to work that hard on that one.
I think. First is Kiss Alive.
Oh, nice.
Because it was really the first record that I went out on my own to get, and my parents weren't happy. And they're like, if you want more Kiss records, you're going to have to buy them yourselves. Okay. And so it really opened up everything for me. The second most important record would be With Sympathy from Ministry, which is a Chicago band. And this was their first record on Arista Records when they were still considered a synth pop new wave band. But when I heard that and the keyboards and what he was doing, I'm like, I'm in. And then I followed him every step of the way. Al Jorgensen, I'm speaking of, every step of the way through that ministry career into all of his side projects. And then it's just like everything.
Pick something lame. Pick something lame.
The Commodore's Greatest Hits.
Yeah. Hey, that's good, though.
There you go.
The Commodore's Greatest Hits.
I'm telling you, it's so fascinating to speak with people who have other sides of the music industry, because that's what I hope to do with this podcast, is be able to talk to people from other sides and other facets, and so we can all just explore how it all comes together to create music, which I think is why we're all here in the first place. So, James, thanks so much for taking some time. This is awesome.
You're letting me go?
I am. You're done.
Sad.
Dismissed.
Let's do another 2 hours. Well, thanks for having me. Like, as you know, I'm a big fan.
Love it.
And I can't wait to get you insurance.
Maybe. Bye.
Bye. Cool story, bro. We'll talk to you again on another episode in the future.
Cool story, bro.
Cool story.
You ever gotten drunk with Chad Kroeger? I should just stop.
Hold on. That's going to be the first question.
Wow. Oh, my goodness. Well, we are rolling, aren't we? This is Cool Story, Bro. I'm Walt. I'm here with Krista.
Hi.
And this is where we kind of look and see what goes on, how the music business gets where it is. You're like, what goes into it? There are so many different facets. I mean, we all know artists, but there are also other factions to the music industry. And we have one of the guys who's responsible for one of those who is looking the other.
I am a faction person.
He is a faction, yes, of the faction.